Get ready to enter the Thrivetime Show.
We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, and we'll show you how to get here. We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, now we're here.
From the bottom, now we're on the top, teaching you the systems to get what we got. Colin Dixon's on the hooks, I break down the books. Z's bringing some wisdom and the good looks. As the father of five, that's why I'm a dive. So if you see my wife and kids, please tell them hi. It's the CNC up on your radio. And now 3, 2, 1, here we go.
We started from the bottom, now we hit.
Thrive Nation, what is going on? Welcome back to the Thrivetime Show. And as always, you have tuned in right now to your audio dojo of mojo. And today I'm very excited for a multitude of reasons. One, because we are talking about a subject that I just feel like is super duper neglected. I feel like many, many people, they go to college, they go to school, they read all the books, they have a high IQ, but when they get into the workplace, no one's taught them about the EQ, the emotional intelligence. No one talks about this.
Excuse me, what are you talking about? I'll tell you what.
Dr. Zellner, have you ever met people? Have you ever been around people? Have you ever been a person who you have a high intelligence, but yet you're unable to emotionally connect or inspire a team of people to actually execute the vision of the business? Have you ever seen that happen where somebody's very smart, but they cannot execute?
Yes, and we call them robots. They are from another planet, and we think Clay could be certified as one, so there's no better person to talk about overcoming this problem than Claytron Clark. Yes.
Now, today we're talking about emotional intelligence, why IQ matters more than EQ. Here's the big problem. Most people think that you don't qualify to become successful unless you grow up rich or you have a high IQ. A lot of people believe that. However, I'm going to give you a little fun factoid here, Dr. Zellner, from our main man, Tom Corley. And he is the guy who's the founder of the Rich Habits Institute. It's been featured numerous times by Dave Ramsey. He says this, 86%, and I repeat, 86% of wealthy believe in lifelong education and self-improvement versus 5% of the poor. Why does that matter? Because many people, they go to college, they get a degree, let's go with like engineering, or in your case, what, mathematics?
Hey, whoa, time out.
Yeah.
It's Friday. I've just gotten my car to go to lunch. Before you start throwing all these numbers at me, you're just all about jumping into the numbers. I came in tonight, and that's all you've been just throwing numbers at me. I've had to put up like a math block in front of you all
and
night.
And you studied math in college. That was your deal.
Well, it's a thing.
It was a thing.
But here's the deal. Okay, the first questions we got to answer on today's show. It's noon. It's high noon. I'm hungry. Let me just at least start driving to my restaurant, okay? Help me out there, Clay. Where should I go and eat? And then let me get some food in my belly. Then you can throw all these numbers at me.
If you want a statistical probability, a 99% probability of having a great meal.
All right.
Then you want to go to Oklahoma Joe's.
That's a pretty high probability.
If you want almost a certain, I mean, some people go to Oklahoma Joe's and they go, I'm a member of PETA and I don't think we should eat animals. They're probably not going to like Oklahoma Joe's. That's 1% of the population that I know of.
Well, you're probably right. Yes. If you are a vegetarian, you probably don't have barbecue on your milk route. That's probably true.
My wife loves America. My wife, she's a great, great human. But for some reason, she doesn't understand the profundity and the importance of eating animals. And so I don't know that she would like.
Well, you know what you need to do? You need to lock her in a room, a darkened room.
Yes.
And just play this song over and over to her. Just,
I'm ready.
America.
Oh, yeah.
And just have like meat smells going through the room at the same time.
Until I fully indoctrinate her into the smell universe.
Like a brisket. You just opened up right there in the room. She can't see it, but she just smell it.
Now, Z, before we really get deep diving into this emotional intelligence topic, I feel like you and I, we've rehearsed for about 4 minutes.
Okay.
The Feliz Navidad. Now, neither one of us have a firm grasp of harmony.
Well, let's do
one of us have a grasp of the Spanish language.
True, but we got to tease that. That's you got to stick around for that.
That's later.
That's like dessert.
Okay, now you're
that's
good.
Like
I just want to make you have a dance. Someone has to lead. Someone has to follow. You're going to lead.
Okay, I'm gonna
follow.
I'll cue it up, but that's dessert. We got to pick the restaurant, then we got to get our appetizers, then we got to get our entrees, and then we get the dessert. So stick around, folks, because
that's going to happen.
It's the last show before Christmas, and we got to give them something.
We got to give them something. The people want something. We're going to give it to them.
They want something, Clay.
All right, here we go. This is from Carol Dweck. This is the author of Mindset, The New Psychology of Success. She's a woman who graduated from Barnard College in 1967. She earned a PhD from Yale.
That's a four-letter word.
She taught at Columbia University, Harvard University, and the University of Illinois before joining as a Stanford faculty in 2004. She says this, test scores and measures of achievement tell you where a student is, but they don't tell you where a student could end up. So Z, I mean, why is that so important for anyone listening right now who maybe, you know, you got a B. You're a B student. You're a C student. Maybe someone listening right now who's a D student. Why is it so important to understand that your test scores do not indicate where you're going to end up? They just indicate where you are right now academically.
Absolutely. I have my son, I'm very proud of him, who's in optometry school, you know, just had semester break and he finished up his classes. Dad, I'm so disappointed. I didn't make the grades that I wanted to make. He was really beating himself up over it. And I said, listen, son, I've been in practice for 25 years and no patient, not one.
Not one.
Zero. Nada.
Zero?
That's like a small number.
Total zero?
Total zero has ever asked me what my GPA was when I got out of school.
Really?
Yeah, none.
I can't believe that.
I know.
I feel like, here's the deal. I have done very, very well as a business consultant, as a founder of an entertainment company, as the founder of a photography company, as the co-founder of a commercial real estate company. And a lot of people would pull me aside and they would say, I have two questions, Z, before I decide whether I'm going to list my house or my commercial property with you. They always said use. But before I decide to list my property with you, what I want to do is I want to verify. I have two main questions. Question number one, what was your GPA? And I'm like, and they go, question number two, what was the area between the Tigris and the Euphrates River? It was very fertile with silt and such.
It is a very fertile region, by the way.
Mesopotamia, buddy, you don't get the deal. No one asks that stuff. In academia, and I'm if you're listening right now and you're part of academia, I'm sorry you're part of academia. But the thing is, isn't our current education system based primarily on memorization?
You're listening to the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
I'm sorry, I can't remember.
Isn't it based primarily, though, on your ability to memorize things and put them back on a test?
That's education.
But real,
that's
but
the
real
learning.
Napoleon Hill, my favorite author, Napoleon Hill, the best-selling author who wrote Think and Grow Rich, the number one best-selling book of all time for self-help, the guy who was the personal mentor of Oral Roberts, the guy who was the personal apprentice of Andrew Carnegie, he says this. He says that intelligence is defined by your ability. He has a little different definition. He says intelligence is defined by your ability to act upon what you've learned.
Well, that's the key.
Act
upon what you learn. And there's some professions out there that you, by law, you have to jump through a lot of hoops.
8 years of college for you.
Hoops, yes. Hoops. In order to get the license, which is kind of an important thing in some professions, to practice, trying to make it perfect, try to practice that job, that profession.
Yeah, and the thing about it here, Thrivers, if you're listening right now, we're talking today about emotional intelligence. We're trying to encourage you that we have today, we're going to get into the four aspects, the four lessons on how to improve your emotional intelligence. But before we get into the four action items that you can apply, I want to explain something to you. Steve Jobs, the guy who founded Apple, the co-founder of Apple, he dropped out of school before graduating.
Yeah.
Steve Jobs.
Yeah.
And he did pretty well.
I'd say so. Yeah.
Overall. I mean, whatever. Who are we to judge?
If we're on a grading system, I would give him, you know, at least a good solid B+.
I'll say this. I have heard of Apple. But by the way, someone in our office just sold something, so we have cowbell going.
Woo! There's cowbell at cowbell that thing.
At the Thrive15.com world headquarters. Cowbell everywhere.
Now, Thomas, you know what? It needs more.
We need more cowbell.
We need more cowbell.
I have a fever, and the only cure is more cowbell. Now, Thomas Jefferson dropped out after only a few months of formal education. Thomas Jefferson, one of our founding fathers, he dropped out of school, okay? John D. Rockefeller, the world's wealthiest man in the history. If you look him up in today's math, if you look at like the basically if you take it today, what he was worth back then in today's numbers with the inflation index, that guy is unbelievably successful. He says this. He dropped out of high school 2 months before his graduation. Okay, he dropped out 2 months before his graduation. Walt Disney, Richard Branson, never heard of him. Elton John, never heard of him either. James Cameron, you know Titanic? You know the movie Titanic? Never heard of it.
Can I stand on the front of the boat?
Frank Lloyd Wright, the top architect of our time, they all dropped out of school.
Time out. Okay. Flag on the play. Flag on the play. So on this TGIF Friday,
yep,
you're going to, as I'm driving to lunch, you're going to sit there and tell me that the key to success is dropping out of school.
The thing is, I've said that like, I don't know, 27 times in a row does not mean that's the key. The thing is that if you have dropped out of school, if you do not have a favorable academic record, if you do not have a high GPA, it does not disqualify you.
Oh, well, that's a whole different thing than what I'm hearing. I think just a little bit of just drop out.
No.
And
no.
Start a, you know, ver-
you're
start
a doctor.
International,
you're half the show. So you're
start,
a doctor.
Start an international airline, start a theme-based Wonderland park, write songs with a red piano. I mean, I think that's what you're trying to say here.
Well, I'm going to
make a movie about a ship that sank.
Let me read you an excerpt from Inc. magazine clarifies what I'm saying.
Okay.
This is from Inc. magazine. They say, "We know that there are many different types of intelligences and grades only measure a select few, and poorly at that. A GPA does not measure a person's emotional intelligence. It does not measure their leadership ability. It does not necessarily measure their ability to think outside of the box and to solve problems. It does nothing to evaluate a person's ability to predict the needs of society or consumers. It does nothing to illuminate the ability of an individual to work with others and find middle ground in standoffs and conflicts. All of these are vitally important to an individual's success in life, and almost none of them are measured by grades. Grades, GPAs, and standardized test scores largely measure one's ability to answer questions and regurgitate information, and not much else."
This is
Inc.
true.
Magazine.
Absolutely true. And I give that a two thumbs up. And that is, I completely agree with that, by the way. But I guess this shows also, you know, let's do two phases. Let's get both
two phases.
Two phases. So those of you that have not finished your academia and you're not currently in your academia, hey, we're going to let you know that, you know, through today's show, we're going to give you some little steps to do to help you propel you to the next level.
Right.
And also for those of you that did academia and you're living on your mom's couch down in the basement.
You got a degree.
With $60,000 in debt. And you got a certificate you hang on the wall. And you're like, okay, I did the thing I'm supposed to do. Now
a lot of hoodies, though, with your university name on it. A lot of hoodie sweatshirts.
You got all color selections. And they're not hoodies. Hey, Belichick wears a hoodie, so don't get me started.
No, I mean, there's a lot of really good hoodies out there you're going to get. When you're $60,000 in debt at your college, you're going to have a lot of hoodies at this point.
Why not?
Yeah.
I mean, you've got to spend that $60,000 on something.
Now, see, when we come back, we're going to deep dive into the difference between IQ, okay, which is the intelligence quotient, and EQ, which is the emotional quotient. A lot of people know about IQ. You know, how by the way, IQ is all about how well you do on standardized tests, and EQ is how well you deal emotionally with managing other people. And Z, at Dr. Robert Zellner and Associates, or at Z66AA, your auto auction, do you guys ever have to manage people, or is it all robots? I mean, are you all robots at this point?
Yeah, the whole world's going to robots. That's what it's all about. You know.
So you have to manage some people.
You have to manage some people, and that uses the EQ. When we come back, folks, we're going to coach you up, and we'll give you all the tangible steps to get your EQ up.
Here's the deal, okay? I think we're going to sell a ton of cupcakes. Yeah. Why? Because cupcakes are hot right now, and because we have a great name.
Cousins Cupcakes.
Boom.
We're going to the top.
All the way. Now, in order to get to the top, we're going to have to come up with an amazing business model.
I came up with something that I think is going to blow your mind.
And I can't wait to see
it. Can I show you?
Please
do. Can I show you? Okay.
ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you for the first time the Cousins Cupcakes business model, Shelly.
For goodness, Kate, come to Cousins Cupcakes.
What is this? What is this?
What are you doing?
Last week you said we needed a business model.
Not a business model.
Well, what then?
I'm talking about a business model.
Oh.
Come on, man.
Listening to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to Tulsa's only local business radio show and into the audio dojo of Mojo. You are listening right now. We're broadcasting right now from the box that rocks. So I don't know. I'm not going to judge you. I don't know where you're listening from. You're probably listening in a very classy place, probably a beautiful place, probably in your office or in your car. But Z, we're broadcasting today from the box that rocks within the Thrive15.com world headquarters. And for those who do not know what the box that rocks is, can you kind of explain what the box that rocks is all about?
Well, we had some really cool studios back in the corner, and they were kind of, you know, no windows and this and that, and they're really kind of a high end kind of you know,
kind of a swing,
studios,
you do, kind of,
yeah. But we had so many people emailing us and calling us going, are you guys like just out of your mom's basement and this is just all just some kind of a big shell game, and what's going on here? Over and over and over, we thought, you know what, let's just show them our mother's basement. No, what we did is we built out this wall, we put windows on it.
Yeah,
if you're
windows.
Watching Facebook Live, you can see it right now. And so behind us, through the windows, you can see the Thrive 15 Neurocenter, Epicenter. Headquarters.
They're not going to wave at us.
Yeah, they're not going to wave at us.
They're not going to wave at us. No respect.
But so that's the box that rocks, which I kind of affectionately refer to it as the aquarium, because I feel like I'm on a fish as people walk by, you know, going to and fro, looking at us, and we're in here filming. So that's the box that rocks. But you know, Clay, let's just hold on a second. Do you realize that this is Friday?
It is Friday.
It's our last show before the blessed day of Merry Christmas. Of Christmas.
What is that? What, by the way, when you say Merry Christmas, do you say Merry Christmas and go, if you're okay with that? I mean, do you do that, or do you like to say Merry Christmas?
I don't even know. I don't even.
Do you say Merry Christmas?
Well, of course I do. Merry Christmas,
because
I want people to have a Merry Christmas, so I say Merry Christmas.
Well, you're very, very over the line politically.
Well, okay, then.
Not a political show. I just want to make sure.
That's another show. I'm not going to teach you how to plant your tulips either, so no home and garden here. But here's the deal. Clay, remember when you were a little boy?
Yes.
I mean, a toddler. A little robotic toddler. You probably marched in sync around the house, and you had a FAFO or a pacifier, you probably, you know, sucked on it in cadence with your walking, you know, as you're walking through your house, I'm sure, as a small child. I mean, knowing you, right?
Yeah, I don't know where you're going with this, but I'm going to go with it. I'm going with it. I'm 100% in.
Well, it's just two mornings away, and so I was going to ask you something for our listening audience out there. Can you remember a special Christmas where you just woke up and you had that magical gift that you'd always been wanting? Or was it just like me, always socks and like underwear, and, you know, it was like a week after Christmas?
I had one. My grandma Dorothy is my dad's mom. Her name is Grandma Dorothy. We called her Grandma Dot, which was short for Dorothy.
Yes.
And she came up from Waco, Texas, home of the Baylor Bears.
Home of the Baylor Bears.
She came up to Tulsa, and I remember waking up, and my grandfather, who I'm named after, his name is Grandpa Clayton. He and my Grandma Dorothy had bought me one of those trampolines from Sam's Club.
Oh, wow.
The big ones?
Yeah, yeah, cool.
At a time and place where we really couldn't afford it.
Yeah.
And I remember waking up, and there was some snow out there, and I remember seeing the trampoline, and it blew my mind. It was absolutely just incredible.
Oh, man, that's awesome.
I mean, it was like, I just couldn't believe it. I'll tell you one thing, and a little story that was kind of fun, is my Grandpa Clayton, he liked to restore cars.
Oh, yeah, that's
and
cool.
And so my
that's
dad good, was 16. Yeah. He drove a 1965 Comet. You know, the red. These are like legendary cars. If you Google it, 1965. Oh, yeah. It has the fins on the back.
Oh,
it's all red.
Oh,
it's like something out of Back to the Future.
Yes.
So my dad, after high school, he thought the car was long and gone. You know, he went to college. He thought the car is probably, you know, it's on block somewhere. It's been sold, whatever.
Yeah.
His dad put it in a storage, and for my dad's 40th birthday, I believe,
yeah,
he gave him a fully restored car. Totally restored the car.
Wow, that's awesome.
As a little gift. And I will just say that this is the season right now where you want to surprise people with some gifts. It's all, and it truly is. It's better to give than receive. And I would just encourage you right now. My dad quit. I think he just stopped smiling like a year after that. I mean, he just could not stop smiling.
That's a great story.
And so if you're listening right now, I encourage you to make a list. I mean, we're talking about emotional intelligence today. We're talking about the importance of emotional intelligence from a business perspective. I mean, we're really getting into how to improve your emotional intelligence and why IQ matters, yes, but why EQ, emotional intelligence, why that really matters. I encourage you, think about some people in your office right now today. Think about somebody in your family. Think about somebody on your team that you could surprise and see why is it so important to emotionally connect and show some love to your team occasionally.
Well, because you have to, because you can't just be the robot. You have to hear. We've taught it before. You can go back to Thrivetime Show and listen to past episodes, and we deep dive into this. But there's two roles you play as the boss. There's two hats you wear as the entrepreneur, as the guy that's in charge, as the leader. One of them is we like to refer to it as the Darth Vader or the dark hat.
Yeah.
And the other one is, we'll say, is the white hat, and that's Grandma Dot.
Hey, you guys want to play volleyball?
Hey, you guys want some cookies?
Does boss want to play volleyball?
You
cool.
You want some more icing on that cookie? Can we just open your mouth? Let me pour that icing just straight
into
your
mouth. Why does boss have a lightsaber all of a sudden?
Why is my arm missing? What,
yeah.
What just happened?
Good comeback up.
You have to play both parts, and it's part of leadership. And you might say to yourself, oh, I don't like playing good cop.
I don't like doing it.
They're all idiots. I just want to crush them.
Cross them all.
They're always late. They're always on their phone. They're always on Facebook. They're always trying to Snapchat and Instagram image and then you might be the one that says, you know, I can't, you know, man, I'm just, you know, I can't play bad cops. I just love it.
All right, let me educate a little bit here. We're talking today about emotional intelligence and why IQ matters more than, we're talking about why EQ matters more than IQ, why emotional intelligence matters more than your IQ. And I'm going to give you, this is the definition of IQ. IQ is defined as how a person scores on standardized tests relative to their age. See, this is something profound to think about.
Oh yeah, I'm listening.
If you take the ACT and you score pretty high as a 22-year-old, but they're an 18-year-old, but then you take the same test when you're 65 and you score the exact same, you actually got dumber according to the IQ.
Yes, of course.
It's relative to your age.
Yes.
Now, EQ is this. It's called emotional intelligence. If your emotion, this is from Daniel Goleman. I want everyone to write that down. Daniel Goleman. Look this guy up. He's a legend, okay? He says this. If your emotional abilities aren't in hand, if you don't have self-awareness, if you're not able to manage your distressing emotions, if you can't have empathy and have effective relationships, Z, then no matter how smart you are, you're not going very far.
You're not going very far. And I tell you what, there's a lot of brilliant people out there, and not to get too deep into it, but there's a lot of brilliant people out there that are brainiacs, that are very, very smart, and they have zero, we call it on the street, we call it common sense, we call it, you know, just street sense, kind of street smart, the ability to just get into a room and make friends and get along with people and read body language.
I'm going to brag on you for a second. I've been out to dinner with you, or we've taken clients out to dinner, and there's something about you where, and I want you to talk about it when we come back, because I've seen do this.
Okay.
And if you've ever, by the way, if you're listening right now, you've ever taken a client out to dinner and you're kind of like, what do I say? Or you've ever met with a client for a presentation, you're going, where do I even start? Because you just want a machine gunner with benefits, benefits, facts, and you just want to
cry, die, or buy.
Yeah, if you're into that and you're not closing any deals, you've got to have an emotional intelligence. If you're out there interviewing people, but no one wants to come work with you. I've seen you do this during dinner, and you've helped people light up like a Christmas tree because you know how to connect with the other person emotionally. You know how to engage them in a conversation. And when we come back, Dr. Robert Zona is going to teach us his super moves.
Okay,
We fill out these papers, become a real business, and then we can get to the fun stuff.
Okay. Do we want to be an S corp or a C corp?
Well, I think S corp stands for serious corporation, sure. And C's for casual. So
I'm more serious. Yeah. You're more casual.
Well,
so
let's just do both of them.
Check them both. Awesome. Okay. Do we want to be nonprofit or profit? I want to make money. So
yeah, profit. But I don't want to come across as greedy.
That's true. Okay. I'm gonna mark nonprofit because it sounds better.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Why are we even doing this?
Well, this is a limited liability form, so we become a limited liability.
Wait. Limited liability?
Yeah.
I don't want to put any limits on this. We're going to the top.
Yes, we are.
How about unlimited liability?
Yes.
Put that down. Put it down.
Okay, I don't see that here.
Well, let's put a UN in front of the word.
Oh, honey, I think you picked up the wrong form. We need an unlimited liability company. We want to be a ULLC.
No, you want to limit your liability. That's the whole point.
Honey, this thing's going to be huge, so.
Why are you putting limits on us, Laura?
I'm not. If someone sues your business, they can't take our personal stuff.
I'm not scared of that.
Okay, honey, I think if we're at the point where we're making so much money that we're being sued, I think we're doing pretty good.
Real good, guys. Real good.
I didn't realize you had a PhD in accounting.
You can't get a PhD in accounting.
Bye, honey. Hey, give Jimmy a call.
Who's Jimmy?
You know Jimmy, the guy who's been arrested like 3 times and the court appointed him a lawyer?
Let's give him a call.
Call him up.
Jimmy?
Man, these guys are going to have a rude awakening when they get sued for the first time. There's a lot of legal hurdles you have to jump through when you start a business, and it pays to know what you're doing so you don't have problems in the long run. If you need help, then check out Thrive15.com. We have world-class mentors who teach thousands of courses in legal, management, and 18 other business categories. So if you're looking to start a business, grow your business, or advance in your career, Thrive15 is where you want to be. You can click below to start with a free trial, or click over here in this direction to watch some samples of trainings or to take the tour. And if you have any specific business questions, we can help with that too. Our mentors have new content released on a weekly basis, and most of those trainings are based off of your questions. That's right. The trainings are actually answers to the questions you are looking for. So what are you waiting for? Click below to get started, and until I see you again next time electronically, thrive on.
Where are the Rutherford files?
I shipped them.
You shipped them?
I FedExed them to Dallas, like you said.
Give them to Dallas.
What's up?
Yeah, hold on a second. Hey, Deborah, can you pick up my kids?
Just get the other stuff to Austin.
Is anyone here named Austin?
Do you guys even know what kind of pressure I'm under?
Hey, can somebody make me some food?
Appreciate you guys.
Oh!
Yeah, you do, boy, bye! Who's gonna pay for my yacht insurance?
Bump it on over to Hibetica.
Oh, yeah. See how that made it better?
Hey, can somebody rub my feet?
Good job!
Hey, Jerry, can you hand me that brown file? Yeah, no, it's good. I'm not doing anything.
You can't keep up this pace. You can't keep doing this early morning stuff. You should just get a job. This is crazy, right? Who in your family has ever owned a business?
Who's gonna help you?
Who do you think you are?
You don't even know what you're doing.
You're gonna fail.
This is so hard.
You can't do this.
You're gonna fail.
Get a job.
You're gonna ruin everything.
This is crazy.
You didn't finish college. You never finish anything.
Just quit.
You know you want to.
You can't do this.
Quit.
Stop. Let's do this.
We're gonna make double instantly. All right, I gotta go. I'm in a networking thing. What's up? My name's Steve. What do? I make everyone more money. You give me $2, I give you $3. Boom, doubled. That's how we do it.
Hi, my name is Becky, and I do interior design, and I'm really good at it.
My name's Kyler. I'm into photography. I like to take pictures of just life and really existence, you know?
Oh my gosh, I just get so nervous at these networking things. I'm just like, oh, Marlene, calm down. You can do it.
I was at a networking event in China, okay? I don't even speak Chinese, but I got 3 businesses, doubled their yen, all right? Think about that.
You think I look hot? We should be Facebook friends.
I don't believe in business cards. You know, I just think, like, if the universe wants us to work together, you know, that our paths would cross. I had a pregnancy scare, and that really changed me. I thought, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do with a sixth? Why am I here networking with vicometers? No offense. Why am I here? So I can stay humble.
I didn't come here just to flirt with you. Maybe.
They took a pint of fluids from my lower back. I'm starting to get the feeling that the universe doesn't want me to get to know you.
Do you think I look like Reese Witherspoon?
That is how I passed my kidney stone.
You gotta go. Bill Gates. See ya.
Hey, Bill. Great meeting you. Can I have your number? Please? No. Where are you going?
Listening to the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the Thrive Time Show, and away we go. We are talking about how to start and grow a successful business, and specifically today, we are talking about a topic that I just don't feel like enough people invest time fully understanding. We're talking about emotional intelligence. What does that mean?
What does that mean?
A lot of people have a high IQ, which is the intelligence quotient.
I am extremely intelligent and smart and made 4-point plus grades.
And yet they go into the workforce and they struggle to have success. And then when they read about Richard Branson or Henry Ford, or they read about Oprah, they realize some of the people that are winning in the world of business have a high emotional intelligence.
Aha.
And so we spend so much time in formal education teaching, IQ and how to improve your test scores. But today we're teaching you about something that no one ever talks about. It's how to improve your emotional intelligence. And there's a great book. It's a best-selling. It's a New York Times best-selling book. I encourage everybody to get an audiobook version of. It's called Emotional Intelligence by Daniel Goleman. And he will get deep. He'll deep dive. I mean, he's almost like scuba diving into this topic. But the guy next to me, Dr. Robert Zellner, he has, you have spent so much time and so much energy studying and looking into how to become the most effective person you could possibly be in the area of emotional intelligence. And Z, you have this rule called the rule of six.
Yes.
When you take somebody out to dinner, when you take a client out to dinner, a prospect out to dinner, you call it the rule of six. What is it?
Well, it's the rule of six. If you've ever been at a dinner party, if you've ever been at dinner with some of your friends, you'll notice that if there's ever more than six, you'll get multiple conversations that break out at dinner.
Whoa. Let me make sure I'm getting this. Knowledge bomb. I'm going out to dinner, and if there's more than six people, there's multiple conversations.
So if you're trying to, I like to use the word gather. Now you can plug in, there's other terms to use, but if you're trying to gather somebody, if you are trying to connect with somebody and you are taking them to dinner, don't have a big dinner party. Don't have, 12, 13, 14 people there. You want to be, because you get six, you're never going to be too far away from them sitting down. It's just impossible with the table, okay? Maybe a round table would be the preference, but even a squared off table, you're still going to be pretty close to them where you can have a conversation. Because if you're spending your money and you're trying to connect with someone, you're selling and you want to gather them, then you have to understand that. So if you have 10 people there, there'll be 2-3 conversations going on, and guess what? You won't have the time, the quality of time to be communicating with that person.
And the conversation starts to feel like this. All right, Z, how you doing? Hey, you're just it's not happening.
Yeah, and you can't, the thing about it is that, hey, if you're spending your money and you're trying to build your business, because that's what this show is about, we're here to give you practical business tips on how to start and grow a business, because according to a little thing called Forbes, there's quite a few, more than not listening right now, it's in there, you want to get your own thing going, you've got an idea that's been percolating down deep inside.
Percolating.
And so this show's about practical business tips. And yes, listen, intelligence is important. Knowing your business, knowing the numbers, knowing your stuff. That's the good thing. That's yes. Over here, read the books and understand, remember, regurgitate all that. That's good over here. But this emotional side of it, the ability to gather up, the ability to sell.
Sell.
Because here's a little.
Sell. I'm kind of above selling. I mean, I feel like I'm sort of a guy. I'm more about the vision. I don't sell. I've got more of a big. I watch a lot of TED Talks, okay?
Well, even if you don't sell, you're going to have to hire someone to sell for you. And you have to sell them on the idea of coming to work for you to sell your stuff.
Is that
a little too deep? Is that weird? Does that go weird?
Okay, here we go. There are five aspects of emotional intelligence that I want you to break down in the context of a dinner party or meeting humans. Here we go. One is self-awareness. You got to know your emotions as they happen. Daniel Goleman says this, scheduling downtime as part of your routine is hard but worth it. Personally, even professionally. Self-awareness. Why do you have to be self-aware?
Take the high road to the low spot.
Oh, man.
What does that mean?
I don't even know. It's like a haiku within a haiku within hyperbole. I don't know.
That means, listen, you dummy yourself down, all right?
Okay.
We've all been with that person that thinks they are, how do you say it? I don't want to sound mean. You're sitting there, you're having lunch, it's Friday, you're maybe shopping, and you got your earbuds in, you're listening to the show, yeah, and you're thinking, what's this we going to say? What's he going to do? The dude at the dinner party that thinks he's all that and a bag of chips.
Hey, now I want just, to, I don't want to name drop, but the last night I had dinner with Bo Jackson's ex-girlfriend and Charles Barkley's friend, his was cousin, Raymond was there, who works directly for Fast Company. Well, a subsidiary of Fast Company.
But I'm not going to name drop because
I wouldn't do that. But I will say my I happened to drive a Porsche tonight, and I love Porsches. How about you guys? Z, how about you?
Yes, exactly. And so the thing about it is this, is that being self-aware, listen, if you take the high road to the low place, in other words, if you are always thinking that, you know, you're not trying to put yourself above where you are. Now, that's easier said than done. Okay. So you're kind of going, okay, so where am I? So what does that mean? So always put the focus back on the person you're trying to gather, number one. Don't talk about yourself. Don't name drop. Don't talk about, if you have to tell them, you know, successes you've had, you're not playing the game correctly.
Ooh.
Okay? You're not playing the game correctly. And the game is to gather and to sell. And that's what we're talking about here. Okay? And in business, when you have the ability to do that, then your emotional EQ is up. All right. And so being self-aware is this,
okay,
is not overestimating someone's interest in your personal doings and comings and goings.
Hey, real quick. I'm sorry, because this when you said this, this just lit a fire of desire.
Uh-oh. Is that time?
Here's the deal, Z. I want to ask you, why is it so important not overestimate someone else's interest in your topic?
Come on. Because when you do, they become very disinterested.
Disinterested?
Yes.
What?
I don't know how many times I've been with someone and they have gone on and on and on, and they're not reading my body language. They're not seeing that I am completely checked out. They just kind of continue driving the Jeep over this wilderness of bumpiness that is just, you know, out there in no man's land. And I'm sitting there looking at them, and I'm eating, you know, my soup or whatever it is. And
you're done with your soup. You've eaten all your soup now.
I've ordered more soup. Can I get some more?
You've started to eat the bowl.
I'm breaking the bowl in pieces to eat it. Hopefully a shard will catch
my
throat.
You're pulling out your eyelashes at this point. You're just
to take me away, you know. Down to the hospital. No, but the thing about it, folks, listen, read people's body language. Pay attention. Pay attention to people, okay? So when you're talking about a topic, it better not be about yourself, okay? And if they ask you a question, answer about yourself, answer quickly and turn that back on them.
See, let's not talk about me. Let's talk about how you feel about me.
Let's talk about it. Well, here's the deal. When someone asks you a question, they say, hey, Clay, what are you doing for Christmas?
Well, I'm doing...
Nine times out of ten, they're expecting that question asked back to them. So they're really coaching you on what to ask them.
Oh.
So Clay, what are you doing for Christmas?
Well, we're going to have Aubrey. We're going to surprise him with a super incredible Husqvarna sponsored gift.
Okay, enough about you. Let me tell you about my Christmas. No, so you listen. I listen, let you finish.
Now, Z, so what are you doing for Christmas, my man?
I'm flying out to Guatemala to see my new grandbaby.
You mean Guatemala with a G and a U and a...
Guatemala.
And are you going on a plane or are you walking?
Well, I think I'm going to walk some, but I'll be mostly in a plane.
Did you book that online?
I think I walked through the airports.
So again, the whole point is people, their favorite topic is themselves, okay? So you want to focus on the other person, okay? You want to dial in and let the other person know they are, for one night, the most interesting person in the world. You have to do that. If you want to emotionally connect with the other person, you've got to make them feel as though they are the most interesting person in the world. The most selfish thing you can do is let the other person feel like they are the most intelligent and interesting person in the world.
Just cleaning the bathroom.
Looks good. Let's go to lunch.
All right.
You're listening to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
All right, Thrive Nation, how are you doing? How are you doing? I tell you what, it's an honor and pleasure for me to be on the show here with you every day, because I remember what it felt like to try to start and grow a business and not know what the heck I was doing. And one of the things is that I scored pretty high on a lot of different aptitude tests, and a lot of those tests in high school where the teacher goes, well, based on your test scores, you should be, you know, that kind of thing. But man, I had no idea what I was doing when I got into the marketplace about selling and emotional intelligence. And you know, the thing is, in school and formal education, I kept being told, wow, you're scoring high on these tests. I actually was in a school for the gifted for a while there. And I'm just telling you what, when you get into the world of business, all of a sudden your emotional intelligence begins to matter almost more than your overall intelligence, in terms of your formal education, your academic intelligence. Z, we were just talking about how if you're, we're talking specifically about if you're taking someone out to dinner, the importance of making sure that you have a plan, you have a specific process. And you mentioned briefly in the previous segment about your rule of six. Can you kind of explain what the rule of six is for anybody who's just now tuning in? The rule of six when you're having a dinner party to gather a group of people and maybe close a deal?
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about business tips, and there's a lot of business done over dinner. There's a lot of business done over lunch. There's a lot of business done over small meetings like this, over coffee. It's a thing. It's actually a thing. Or a latte. So the idea is this, is that when you have more than six people at the meeting, and it's a casual meeting, in other words, you're at dinner, okay? It's not like, okay, this is a formal meeting, take your seats, please, and turn your book open to page 4.
Smith, grab your seats, please.
Yes, please be quiet while you're sitting down. Yeah, it's not a formal meeting. We're talking about a casual meeting, okay? And so most of those happen at a restaurant. So that's the excuse. I mean, that's the example we're going to go with.
Yeah.
So if you have more than six, what'll happen is that I'll be talking to someone, and then someone will get disengaged, and they'll turn to the person next to them, and they'll start talking, and pretty soon you have two or three conversations going on. But if you have six or less, you'll be able to hold to one conversation, because you'll be able to then get everybody involved in the conversation, and you won't have to go to multiple conversations, okay?
So if you're going out to dinner, you want to observe the rule of six, but there's five aspects of emotional intelligence. One is self-awareness. Two is managing the emotions. I'm going to read this to you. It says, managing emotions. The ability to handle feelings and bounce back quickly from setbacks. Notable quotable from Daniel Goleman. Daniel Goleman, look up that guy. He wrote the book called Emotional Intelligence. It's a game changer and a New York Times best-selling book. He says this, there is zero correlation between IQ and emotional empathy. They're controlled by different parts of the brain. Oh, come on, Daniel. What does that mean, Z? Why is it so important that you can manage your emotions?
Well, you have to really kind of be prepared for it up front. For men, we have a delay. The way our brains are wired is it actually is a little bit of a, you have to go to a different part of the brain to get into that. Women, I hear they're more like a, their brain's more like a set of like a bowl of spaghetti. It's just all more intertwined.
Oh my gosh,
and so they can get into those emotions easier. In fact, it's almost hard for them to have a conversation without getting into the emotional part of their brain. Yeah. But for a man, our brain's more like, say, a waffle with its little, you know, like a waffle iron with a little, you've got a little cup here and I can be in that. And
me, forget about everything. Sales leads, call sales leads, close deal.
Forget about everything else and just be in that little space in my brain. Yeah. And that's why guys can sometimes be, you're like, you're not being very sensitive right now.
Me, you know? No sensitive. Me, sell stuff.
Me
right
have
now.
Club, hit me you in back head, drag you out of cave.
Boom.
Boof, that just happened.
Now, so man, you have to be kind of proactive about it. I think what you probably should do is before the dinner party, slap yourself a few times, get up a good cry, and then
I'm going to rip on myself here about managing emotions real quick. I'm going to rip on myself. I'm going to give you an example of what not to do. Old school story, but this is true.
Okay, let's hear it.
Back in the day, I had a company called DJ Connection, which before I sold it, we were doing about 4,000 events per year. If you go to djconnection.com, the company still exists, but it was the world's largest wedding entertainment company. And I have a thing on my desk where even today, I don't want anyone touching my stuff, period. I have my man cave. Just don't touch my stuff. So in my man cave, you know, I have my own way I set up things. Back in the day, I had a desk, and over on my left side, I remember I had a red stapler.
Okay.
Then I have like my scissors, and I have my highlighters, and I have my perfect Sharpie pens, and I have my notebook where I would write in almost like a 9-point font. Now I type it, but I would write out my agenda for the day.
That's so awesome.
And I would just very detailed. I would come to work at usually, you know, not that I was counting, but specifically at 3:30 a.m. I'd get to work at 3:30 a.m. right there. Boom. I would walk in, and I remember one day I go, "Who has moved the sales leads?" And I was a young entrepreneur, and I'm like, I mean, it's almost like 3:30 in the morning. I almost have like a panic attack.
You're listening to the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
You can understand the detail of that you need to have in place to book 4,000 events. That means we're booking 80 weddings a weekend, which means we have to talk to 150 to 160 prospects a week, which means we all have to follow the same script. Or there's a system.
There's a system, yeah.
And I'm going, I mean, I remember talking to the guys at 9. I'm like, I almost wanted to yell at them, but I was like, who has moved the sales leads?
You are kidding me.
And one of the guys.
It was not that traumatic.
It was. I was so mad because we were growing so fast and I had no free time in my schedule because I was the one who was the closer. I didn't know how to scale it up yet. And I'll go, who did it? And one of the guys goes, well, I you took them home. You know, I'm like, you took the leads, the very lifeblood of our business? And he goes, I was going to make some calls, you know, from home. And I'm going, oh my gosh, why would you do that? And I tried everything within me. I'm like, I cannot freak out. But emotionally, I looked like Doc Brown. You remember Doc Brown from Back to the Future?
Oh yeah, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, the Marty, fuzzy hair.
Marty, let me guess. You are part of the future. You're part of the Coast Guard. And he's like, no,
oh, yeah,
no.
He's got the little vest on.
You got the little vest on. You know? Yeah. So it's this thing. So I'm like freaking out. So I emotionally get it together, but I still feel that inner panic. And it's like maybe 9:50. And I look and I'm trying to find my scissors. And I'm like, who took my scissors?
No, not the scissors.
And Ms. Ledger, my wife, walks by and she goes like, what is going on? And I'm just, who took my scissors? Are you kidding me? Why would you take my scissors? And I just am going on a huge rant. And I look around the office and there's people totally quiet. It's almost like I have totally destroyed the emotional atmosphere of the office. And there's probably, you know, 20 people, 15 people. And they're all like looking at me like, are we going to lose our jobs?
Are we going to die? No, they're probably thinking, are we going to die?
It was a bad deal. Now that I understand how it works, I should have handled it in a way where I would emotionally not process what was going on. And I would just go, guys, do you know where my lead sheets are? Okay, and then do you guys know where my stapler is? And then I would get out to my car. Do you guys know where my scissors are? And then I would get out to my car, and then I would go, holy crap,
what's going on with my scissors?
But you never want to freak out in front of your team, if at all possible.
If at all possible, you're right. But I think, was that the idea? Do you think that age matured you into that, or do you think just the idea that you did it over and over and over matured you into it? What do you think?
I think there's two things. Okay. One, I just got worn out.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, I just worn out, just firing the cannon all the time.
You're laying over your desk just at 10:30 in the morning, just later you're passed out. You've just been so worn out looking for your scissors.
No, but honestly, my wife has coached me a lot through this. My wife, she is, being married, one benefit of that is my wife is sort of self-aware of my lack of self-awareness. So my wife would go, hey, you just freaked out in one one of your guys is crying. Yeah, yeah. A grown man like crying.
One of your guys is in the corner crying, yeah.
And I was like, okay. So, you know, I've read Daniel Goleman's book, and when I studied it, I realized that a weakness for me was managing my own motivations. Now, point number three is self-motivation. Now, Daniel Goleman says this. He says, every morning, I go off to a small studio behind my house to write. I try to ignore all email and phone calls until lunchtime. Then I launch into the sometimes frantic busyness of a tightly scheduled day. Z, why do you got to be disciplined and self-motivated to be a successful entrepreneur?
Well, it's part of the equation, and that's what we're teaching you out there in Thrive Land. You know, you can be listening live right now on AM 1170,
yeah.
12 to 2, Friday. Happy Friday.
Happy Friday.
Friday before Christmas. Or you can be listening to the show anywhere around the world on the ThriveTimeShow.com, listening to the podcast. And so what we do on this show is we're giving you practical business steps to be a great entrepreneur, and a great entrepreneur has to get this concept down. You have to be self-motivated. If you sit around and wait for someone to motivate you,
oh no,
you're not going to be a great entrepreneur. You're not going to have a successful business. You're not going to get things done. And so having that what you would think is downtime to recharge and to reboot and to get you focused for the day and to kind of just get yourself, hey, we can do this. We can do this. We can do this. I mean, you see guys all the time. I mean, I see it before like a football game or something. They're over there by themselves. They got their beats on their head, and they're just over there their eyes are closed, and they're just kind of going through plays or kind of thinking to themselves. You can see them just self-motivating themselves.
One
you know?
Of my favorite guys was Ray Lewis, and during the I encourage you to check out some Ray Lewis.
Oh, yeah.
But Ray used to get up there, and he'd go, what time is it? And the guys would say, game time. And he's like, I asked you, what time is it? Game time. And he'd get so worked up that the team would all be ready to go.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you what, you talk about in a league where everyone is physically fit, everyone is tough, everyone is hardworking, everyone is top drafted, top college players. The difference between good and great is that adrenaline, that motivation, that the ability. And Andrew Carnegie, the late, great Andrew Carnegie, who was the number two world's wealthiest person, he said that people who cannot motivate themselves must be content with mediocrity.
Ooh.
Look up that quote.
Wow, that hits you right in the pawpaw right there.
Now we come back here, Thrivers. We're going to be talking about empathy, the importance of learning more about how to develop the skill of empathy. Stay tuned. Thrive Time Show. It's beginning.
Hey guys, I'm trying to close the deal here.
Oh, hey.
I'm Josh. I work for Statler Marketing. We're a little startup marketing firm. Well, actually, I wouldn't say startup. I've been on staff for about 5 years now, and the company's doing really well. We've all been in the same office since I started working here. And the problem is we keep adding people and no space. We all share a phone, so. But there's actually some advantages to having a small office. We never have to have meetings, because it's kind of like we're always in a meeting. The break room's real close, so that's convenient. I don't have to leave for lunch. I just can stay here and work all day. There's a lot of togetherness and closeness, camaraderie, and touching. Yeah, we could use a bigger office.
Tiny office space may seem like a good idea to cut costs, but it could also create some problems for productivity. So, how do you find good real estate that is a perfect fit for your business or life? Well, you can start by checking out thrive15.com. We have world-class mentors who teach thousands of courses in real estate, management, and 18 other business categories. So if you're looking to start a business, grow your business, or advance in your career, Thrive 15 is where you want to be. You can click below to start with a free trial, or click over here to watch some samples of trainings or to take the tour. And if you have any specific business questions, we can help with that too. Our mentors have new content released on a weekly basis, and most of the trainings are based off of the questions that you ask. That's right. The trainings are responses to your questions, those answers. So, what are you waiting for? Click below to get started, and until I see you again next time electronically, thrive on.
My name is Keith Boyd.
10 years old. I have been diagnosed with cerebral palsy. There is currently no cure. I cannot walk with my feet. I cannot write with my hands. I cannot speak with my mouth. I have to work harder than everyone else. But that's okay, I've never been afraid of work. My struggles have made me stronger and more determined. I am raising $250,000 for the Little Lighthouse, a school for special needs kids like me. I graduated in 2011, but I wanted to give back. I'm on a mission and I will not be stopped. I wrote a business plan with my eyes. I have a dream. I have a plan. I have a purpose. What's stopping you?
Doing?
I'm just cleaning the bathroom.
Looks good. Let's go to lunch.
All right.
I'm gonna beat all of their competitors' prices, or I'll give you the mattress for free. How's that sound? You look good. Let's sell some mattresses.
Sales for me, you know, it's what makes the world go round. And it's my life. You know, when I step out onto this showroom floor, it's my time to shine. It's my time to nominate. This is my Coliseum, and I'm the gladiator. So, look out.
Hey! Oh. Cameron
Hi.
Coates, nice
Hi.
To meet you.
Mary.
Are we taking care of today? Mary?
Yes.
What
Hi.
A great name. That's beautiful. And you are such a vision.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Oh, Mary, what do I got to do to get you into bed today?
You know, really, I just want to serve the people. I want to use my knowledge to better mankind.
This is 100% memory foam mattress, okay, with a circle knit top. It comes from our King Arthur collection, and we call it Excalibur. Hop on up, Mary.
Oh, no, that's not necessary.
A lot of these guys out there, they're dishonest, you know? But I believe in truth in sales.
This is a limited edition, which means it's a collector's item, which means that it will appreciate in value. So really think of this mattress as an investment into your financial future.
I just love making people smile, you know? If at the end of the day, I've made at least one customer smile, then I've done my job, I've succeeded. I need them to buy something as well, of course, because they don't pay me for smiles. But I would be rich if they did.
Yeah, yeah, I know that the credit cards are maxed, yeah. No, I'm not gonna ask your dad for money again, okay? Listen, I know this is gonna work. I got a good feeling about this one, all right? Okay, I gotta go.
Jim!
Hey!
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 Bob.
Okay, nice to meet you, Bob.
Hey, we're here to get you some capital for your business today.
Fingers crossed, Bob.
Like that. Well, let's just dive in.
Sure.
And we'll unpack it. Tell me about your business.
Yeah, you know, Bob, I just feel like I'm really sitting on a powder keg right now. And this industry is about to blow. All we have to do is light the match. You want to light it with me, Bob?
Well, let's see.
Sure.
What is this business?
Yeah, it's the party business, but more specifically, it's the pet party business.
Like for animals?
Yeah, dogs, cats, fish. We've done a couple ducks.
So you throw parties for pets.
Birthday parties, weddings, graduations, anniversaries, office parties, proms, we do it all.
Okay. So what can we do for you?
Really, Bob, we're a young company, but my phone's blowing up. And I probably get a call about once a month, and I can only see that doubling in the future. So I need a massive building that I can call my call center.
That's what the capital is for.
Right. Let me tell you this, is that there are 180 million pets in America, and all they want to do is party. That's it. And who are we to stop them, Bob? One call center away.
Okay. Have a few standard questions for you.
Bring them on.
Yep. There you go. Okay. What are your net earnings?
Netted. You know, they're very netted. I net them myself, so it's all good.
What I mean is, how are your profits?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're rebounding.
Yeah. Rebounding, so mm-hmm. You're losing money.
Oh, yeah. But, you know, I say it's addition by subtraction.
Jim, do you have any real figures that you can show me?
I do. Figure this, Bob. I'm not trying to sell a product here, okay? What I'm trying to sell is the American dream. You can't put a price on that.
Do you have a cost analysis?
No.
Balance sheet?
No.
P&L?
I don't know what that is.
Do you have anything you can show me today?
A can-do attitude, and it's right here. You're looking at it.
We need a little more than that, Jim.
Okay. Time out. I thought this might happen. So what I did is I brought a satisfied customer. Say hello to Pebbles.
Hey there, Bob. Give this guy all the capital he needs.
What are you doing?
Oh, come on, Bob. This business is perfect.
Thanks, Pebbles. And a pun. You're so funny.
You're talking for the animal.
Come on, Bob, and let's party.
Get out.
What if we renamed it Party Animals?
Get out.
Dadgummit.
Broadcasting from the center of the universe, featuring optometrist turned entrepreneur, Dr. Robert Zellner, and U.S. SBA Entrepreneur of the Year, Clay Clark. This is the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Here we go. Here we go. Welcome back to the Thrive Time Show. It's your audio dojo of Mojo Faux Show. We are broadcasting from the left coast of the Arkansas River within the beautiful Thrive15.com world headquarters and within the box that rocks. My name is Clay Clark. I'm the former SBA Entrepreneur of the Year. And guess who is here? It is Dr. Robert Zellner. This is a guy who built an optometry clinic. He goes on to build an auto auction. He goes on to build a horse breeding facility. What does that mean? The point is, he's had some success. He has A to Z Medical. He's invested in a bank.
Blah, 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 blah.
People
blah,
know
blah,
him.
Blah.
People know him. It's Dr. Robert Zellner.
Here's the deal, folks. Clay and I have a passion to coach you up on how to start a business or to grow a business or to just have success in business. Let's just call it that, just success in business. So a couple of years ago, we started down this wonderful path of scaling business coaching. And we did that with Thrive15.com. It was so successful. It went over so well that radio stations approached us and said, hey, can you guys do the same thing on a radio show?
We've never done it before.
Apparently, it's you get on and talk about the stuff that we've been talking about for 2 years.
Let's form a committee.
So that's what we did. So, hey, we are just as surprised as you are by the success of the show.
And it's been a kind of a high point of our entrepreneurial coaching career. We're so excited. And we have a guy, a guy snuck in. It's hard to sneak in when you're 6'8" of great, but we have the executive producer. He's normally behind the scenes, the executive producer of the Thrive Time Show. It's Mr. Marshall Morris. How are you, sir?
I'm doing awesome. I'm glad we got this tall table in here finally to, you know, give me a couple extra inches with the
mic. Ain't no fable. It's a tall table, bro.
Look at that. No fable. It's a tall, tall table.
Now we're talking today about emotional intelligence because so many people in college, we study memorization, we study how to score high on tests, we study the academic syllabus, but a lot of times we don't know how to do well in the world of business because no one teaches us the emotional intelligence. And so we're moving on to the fourth.
Wait! I want to brag on Marshall for a minute.
Yeah,
I'm going to brag on Marshall.
Oh, come on now.
No, this is the truth because I had a dude I had a dude somewhere in the world.
Yeah.
His name was John. That's a pretty common day, but really, his name is John, okay?
Sounds like a bar name.
sounds like this is a made-up story or something. And he contacted me and said, hey, listen, I've got a buddy of mine who just started a business, and he is failing miserably.
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 He's at the bottom of the barrel.
And he goes, I would like to gift him a year of Thrive15.com or get him some business coaching or what do I do? And I said, here's I'm gonna do a little something. I want you to mystery shop just a little bit for me. He goes, well, what does that mean? I said, I want you to email Thrive15 at info@thrive15.com.
You didn't mystery shop your own company, did you?
Yes, I did. I did a sneaky McSneakers in, and you guys didn't even know it. And I'm telling you about it right now on the Friday show. Everybody's eating, finishing up their lunch, and getting ready for Christmas and Santa Claus. So I'm gonna pull this on you. Okay, here comes Santa Claus. So you know, no, so he emails in, and so I'm waiting, you know, I'm thinking, and so it's a day or two later he calls me.
You're like, loving this. You're just waiting.
Oh, I know. I'm milking this one because it's a good story. And he calls me. Couple days later, he calls me back and says, oh, my gosh.
Oh, my gosh.
And anytime a buddy starts off a conversation with, oh, my gosh, you're like, oh, no, this is either going to be really, really good or it's going to be really, really bad.
It's going to end weird, Greg.
It's going to hit this. Billy. So he said, your team is awesome. And I was like, ooh, wow. Oh, okay. This is going the right direction. And they said, that Marshall called me, and he was just full of information. He handled he was appropriate. He got me signed. He answered all my questions. He got me signed up. I feel so. You've got a studly team there.
And I'm going to brag on Marshall. He wore pants that day.
Wow.
That was the first step for success.
Now, Marshall's also the co-author of the Start Here book, which you can find on Amazon, which is humbly the world's best business book. Now, we're talking about point number four, which is empathy today. We're talking about emotional intelligence. Point number four is empathy, okay? Recognizing emotions in others, teaching sales and management. Notable quotable. This just in from Daniel Goleman, a notable quotable. He says, in a high IQ job pool, soft skills like discipline, drive, and empathy mark those who emerge as outstanding. Now, Marshall, I'm going to ask you. You oversee the HR pipeline for Thrive15.com, Clay Clark Enterprises, a lot of the businesses we're involved in, and you see candidates come in all the time, many of which who have very impressive resumes.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, every Tuesday at 5, we interview a nice crop of people.
Yep.
A nice crop. Did you say crop?
A crop.
Okay.
A wonderful crop of people. And I'm telling you, this week, about 4 weeks ago, there's one lady, I'm going to brag on her. We have a lady named Teresa who works up here. We have a guy named Alex who works up here. And we have a guy named Mike who works up here. Mike is actually on the other side of the camera right now.
Yeah.
What is it that stood out to you about Teresa, Mike, and Alex? I mean, real talk. What is it about their empathy, their skills to empathy that stood out to you? How did you know, okay, there's somebody beyond just a high resume and a high IQ here? There's something happening here.
Well, I wouldn't say beyond a high resume. I didn't read any of the resumes.
What? Come on.
So that's the first thing. And then when I actually had them in the interview, you look for the intangible things that indicate emotional intelligence. Things like taking notes, being detail-oriented. Things like engaging and making eye contact with me while
I'm talking. Don't look at me.
Yeah. And so
I'm going to time out real quick because I want to ask Dr. Z. Z, you've seen this. According to Inc. Magazine, if you want to look at Harvard, maybe you want to Google search tonight, Forbes, the majority of people out there will lie on their resumes. They just may make stuff up. And so a lot of employers have got to a point where they really don't even read the resume until an interview has happened because it's kind of like,
yeah,
what's the point?
Yeah.
So, Z, when you interview somebody back in the day when you used to do that yourself,
yes,
and
yes,
when your team interviews people, talk to me about what Marshall's getting into. You're looking for subtle cues. You're going, is this person, you know, the right fit? Are they not? And a lot of it has nothing to do with where their degree is or where they graduated from. You're looking for certain cues. What are those cues you're looking for?
Well, I boil it down to one simple thing. I really do. I boil it down to one simple thing. As I talk to them, as I notice their body language, all the things Marshall was pointing out, they give you eye contact, or they taking notes at the appropriate time, or they trying to sneak a text in on their phone. I mean, whatever it is, whatever
During
it is.
During an interview, people do this
stuff. Oh my gosh, all the time. Yeah. But here's what it boils down to this. It boils down to this. Do I want to spend time with this person? The thing that is most valuable to me in the day, and the thing that I can't get back once I spend it, is time. Do I want to spend time with this person when I don't need to? And a lot of times I'll boil it down to that one simple thing. And there's a lot of things that go into that. And that kind of touches on this emotional intelligence that we're talking about. And that's being in tune with it and paying attention. But if I say no to that, odds are I'm not going to hire that person.
You taught me that. And I'll say this. Your ability, you have such an ability that you've developed over time to manage time. You're absolutely a wizard.
You're listening to the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
And one of the things that I did wrong for so many years is there was people that I didn't want to spend time with because they were so ridiculous. So let me give you an example. If you apply for a job at Thrive15.com, if you're watching right now on Facebook Live, and maybe you can zoom out if you can see the Israeli flag. Can you see the Israeli flag back there? Give me the American flag. Can you
dark.
See that?
It's a little dark.
Well, here's the deal. We have an Israeli flag in the office and an American flag. Many people ask me, why do you have an American flag at the Thrive15.com world headquarters? And I say, because I'm so humbled and appreciative for the freedom we have. You understand, freedom wasn't free. People had to fight and die for it. I mean, it's the idea that you could start a business and grow a business. I mean, we don't have to worry about it. I mean, I've traveled all over the world, and I'll tell you one thing. When you worry about your safety, it's really hard to focus on growing a business. And so I put that up there. And I'm telling you, even during the interview process, people will say, the wrong candidates will say, well, why do you have an American flag? And you'll go, well, because, you know, I'm proud of our country and I realize the sacrifice that represents. Well, Colin Kaepernick, though, he kind of has a point. And I'm like, well, screw Colin Kaepernick. He's wrong. And like, they're going, what? And I go, I wouldn't want you in my office if you think that way. I'm just being real. And that's just my, I'm not saying
I know.
That's my thing.
Yeah, exactly. And so when you ask me that, it really boils down to that. Because here's the deal. When you hire someone, you are saying yes to that person being on your team, number one, but also being in your life, number two. And then number three, that you're spending time with them, that if you didn't hire them, you wouldn't have to spend time with them.
You've got to recognize their emotions. You've got to recognize their emotional state. And you know what? That person might be a perfect fit for Whole Foods or Starbucks or Apple or a different company, but they might not be the right fit for your business. So you've got to have that empathy deal. Now, point number five, this is the fifth aspect of emotional intelligence. You got to know how to handle relationships. Daniel Goleman says this, we need to recreate boundaries when we carry a digital gadget that creates a virtual link to the office. You need to create a virtual boundary that did not exist before. Dr. Z, preach it. Why is it so important for you? Because you now have hundreds of people that work with you, that you are honored to work with, and they're on your team. It's awesome. You had your Christmas party the other day, your Dr. Zellner Enterprises Christmas party. And there were literally, and I'm bragging on you, literally hundreds of people that were there, and their families depend upon you. And you know what? You also depend upon them. And these people, many of them have worked with you for over a decade. It was an awesome, I'm telling you, it's almost a tear to the eye moment when I see a guy like Dr. Boatwright, and I realize how much you guys have worked together, and Monty. It's awesome. And I hear you brag on them all the time. It's awesome, that crew that you've assembled, that team. But you, at some point, have had to learn to create boundaries when you go home, where even though you love these people, you have to eventually kind of create a separation, because there's hundreds of people, and if they all just reached out to you once a day, you'd never have any time for yourself.
Absolutely. I love the way, sometimes you ask a question that you answer before you hand it off to me, but I think it's kind of funny.
No, but you would never have time.
No, you're absolutely correct. I would never have time, because here's the deal, and this is going to sound mean. And Clay, it's very sweet what you just had to say, by the way. And that is a special time for me. And here's the deal, is that I wish I had enough time in the day to have a special bond and relationship with every single person that works for me. I really do. Yeah. I wish the day was 187,000 hours long and I could sit around, you know, for chunks of time and just get to know everybody that works for me.
And then Red Bull just was flowing and you would never have to sleep.
Yeah, just never have to sleep. But here's the deal. You have to guard your time and you have to guard your personal life and you have to limit, and it's going to sound mean.
Uh-oh.
You have to limit the people that have access to you. So hundreds of people in the room, Clay, and I really appreciate what you just said.
No, I mean, I'm serious. But, you brag on them all the time.
But here's the deal. Only a handful of those people have have you know have the ability to contact me. Like Steve Jobs, you know, he'd walk through Apple, some dude would be like, "Hey, Steve."
He had a rule of six.
He wouldn't even look at him.
He wouldn't even.
His little black, you know, turtleneck on, you know.
Thrivers, you got to read that. You got to read his book. He seriously would not acknowledge the physical presence of more than six people at a time. True story.
I mean, and he would just walk on by. And what he did is he encouraged those six to have six, and those six to have six, and so he had a hierarchy down.
Yeah.
But those six, whenever they needed him, come rain or shine, you know, I mean, they could call him and bam, he'd be there. They could email him, he'd respond. They could text him, he'd respond. They could call him, he'd answer the phone. I mean, those six had access to him.
Now, when we come back, I want Marshall to be able to walk us through, because Marshall, he coaches clients all over the world. People reach out to Thrive15.com for many times they want one-on-one coaching. And what happens is they want to learn Dr. Zellner, his 13-point business system. They want to learn what are the systems that have allowed Dr. Zellner to be successful in optometry and the auto auction and the bank, different businesses. How is he doing it? And they'll reach out to Marshall. They'll text him on a Sunday. They'll text him on a Saturday. And the guy's trying to get married, okay, ladies? He's got a line of ladies applying to go on dates with the guy. And he's just trying to find the right dream weaver. And he's got to create some certain digital boundaries at some point where he goes, look, it's Sunday. I'm on a date. I can't respond. And it's tough because he's passionate about helping them grow their business. So you go back. Marshall's going to talk about when he turns the phone off and when he starts hitting on the eligible ladies, you know, the eligible virtuous ladies. That's when you're away.
Here's the deal, okay? I think we're gonna sell a ton of cupcakes. Yeah. Why? Because cupcakes are hot right now, and because we have a great name.
Cousins Cupcakes.
Boom.
We're going to the top.
All the way. Now, in order to get to the top, we're gonna have to come up with an amazing business model.
I came up with something that I think is going to blow your mind.
And I can't wait to see
it. Can I show you?
Please do.
Can I show you? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you for the first time, the Cousins Cupcakes business model, Shelly.
What
are you doing?
Last week you said we needed a business model.
Not a business model.
Well, what then?
I'm talking about a business model.
Oh.
Come on, man.
You're listening to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Ho, ho, ho. This is the final show before Santa arrives at your house. And for those of you who don't believe in Santa, maybe you're 35. Dr. Z, maybe you're 45. You're going, I don't believe in Santa.
I don't think there's a guy in a big red coat.
Well, I'm going to tell you what. Jesus is real, and Santa is also real. That's all I'm going to say. they coexist. They have a certain relationship. I believe that Santa, he was a close advisor to Jesus, and he's not documented in any biblical text. I don't know if that's it. That, I mean, I'm just telling you, a lot of people are going, how is it possible that Kris Kringle is, I don't know. A lot of your kids are listening right now going, is it possible? Absolutely it's possible. How is it possible? I don't know. How does a cell phone work? Do we still use it? Yeah.
How do they work?
We don't know, but we know that Santa is
That's
real.
That's a different show. That's
Jesus
a different show.
Is real. It's a different show.
That's electronics and you just mixed electronics and the religious broadcast station on the same show as what you just did.
Sorry, just give yourself a swirly, Thrivers, and you'll be able to reset here soon. But we're talking today about emotional intelligence. So we brought a guy on the floor who knows a little something about it. It's Mix Master Marshall Morris. He's the executive producer of the Thrivetime Show. And before we went to the break, we were talking about handling relationships and digital boundaries. And Marshall, literally, he coaches Marshall, how many business clients? Because we try to cap it. We don't want you to coach more than a certain number of clients because there's just so much work. We optimize their website. We build their website. We do their graphic design. We handle their marketing. We handle their sales scripting, their accounting. There's so many things we do for our one-on-one business coaching clients. But how many are you? I mean, how many do you typically work with?
Two dozen. Cap it at 24,
25, that's
yep.
the max.
Yep.
And how hard is it? Because you love these people. You see them. There's a lady in Oregon right now.
She's awesome.
What is her name? Shannon?
Shannon Roberts.
Brag on Shannon for a second.
Shannon is awesome. So Shannon came to us immediately after having moved to a completely new location, and she was specifically looking to open up her beauty lounge.
Yeah.
Okay. And so she went from just an idea and having the skills to do it, and we've built a brand and a business around it. Real talk, the last meeting that we had with her, she was like, oh my gosh, thank you so much for providing this site and everything that you and the rest of the team does. Because it's not me. We have an entire team.
What's her website? Where can people find her?
LoftyBeautyLounge.com.
And so she absolutely loves you. And one more Thriver I want to brag on. They're a Tulsa couple, Rachel and Ryan. Their company's called Tip Top Canine. And these lovebirds, they teach your dog. Like if you have a dog and you're having a hard time potty training your dog or teaching your dog where to, you know, to sit and to obey the commands, they have a company called Tip Top Canine. And their business is doing great. They're growing. They're getting online leads. And you know what? I would spend every waking moment of my life answering the questions of Ryan because he is awesome. He's diligent. He's kind. He's honest. He's a Rama guy. He's a good guy. And you know what? But eventually you have to set those boundaries. So talk to me. You're a single guy. You're out there dating ladies, many ladies on the waiting list to date mixed master Marshall Morris. Talk to me, Marshall. How do you set your boundaries? How hard has it been for you to learn to do that?
It's super hard. So you talked last segment, Daniel Goleman, you've got to create virtual boundaries because for the first time we have virtual connections to the office all the time.
Oh,
texts,
no.
Phone calls, voicemails. And so when you work with 25 clients, you never know when that issue is going to come up for them.
They're going to hit you up on social media.
Social media all
they're
the time.
They're going
to
tweet you.
And they just want to reach out to you.
Because so
you
they care.
But if I'm always working with their time and their schedule, then the thing that's going to be sacrificed is my time and my schedule.
You're listening to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
So I want to get into the four lessons on how to improve your emotional intelligence. Lesson number one is the ventilation fallacy. Venting when you're angry prolongs your mood rather than end it. Lesson number one.
I'm going to fight on that.
Okay.
You go through because I think I've got a little bit different take on that than you do. Well, and so it'll be great because people can listen out there and go, oh, do I believe more? Do I want the clay philosophy or the Z philosophy on this?
Because I've studied a lot of President Obama, what will happen is you'll disagree with me and agree with me at the same time, and either way, you'll leave excited. So here we go.
Okay.
Malcolm Gladwell, he says this is a notable quote from Malcolm Gladwell. He says, practice isn't the thing you do once you're good. It's the thing you do that makes you good. So we're talking about the ventilation fallacy. Venting when you're angry prolongs your mood rather than end it. This is from Daniel Goleman. Z, why do you disagree with this concept, or do you disagree?
No, when you have anger, there's two key components to it that you have to do.
Okay.
That I have learned that I practice. One is validation and one is ventilation.
Oh,
but you have to do them correctly.
Okay.
You have to do them correctly, okay? You have to, validation is where you have to be acknowledged that your anger is righteous. In other words, your anger is okay to have. So if you're talking to your buddy and you're mad about something and you're looking to get it validated and look at you and go, what are you so mad about? It's nothing. You know, I mean, so
they
what?
Touched my stapler.
So what? The guy took a gun and shot you in the thigh. That's no big deal.
He froze, I mean, confused. You know,
I mean, the guy T-boned your car. What are you mad about that? I mean, come on. He probably didn't. You know, I mean, so you want to get validated. In order to get validated, you've got to have safe people to do that with. You've got to have people in your circle that will, you know, not judge and not be upset with you, listen to you and say, oh, you know what? That's an excellent point, and I can see why you're upset about that. Validation, an important part
of
anger. Validation. And the other one is ventilation. But you have to do ventilation correctly. You can't sit there and just vent openly and randomly. Now, that I agree with you. That you can't do. But the problem is that some people stuff down their anger and they don't get it over it properly, and then it boils up even more
since
the next
1975,
time.
I've been upset about this, and I will tell you what, the kids today, they just
have all the meeting. I mean, I'm upset about it.
The kids today do not wear corduroys the right way.
Yes. Turn those hats around. If I see one more kid with their hat on backwards, my grandfather's going to come up from his grave and jerk it off your head.
Okay. I swear, Dr. Z, people today just don't care.
So anyway, so ventilation is when you go and you talk about it, you express yourself, and you let it out. But you can't just do that with anybody. There's three categories you can do that with. Okay.
Okay. Here we go.
One is One is back to the safe people.
Back to the safe people.
Your inner circle, guys that you know will keep it to themselves.
Keep it to themselves.
They want, oh, Clay's really upset about that.
I'll go on social media and post that. That's sweet. He says he's pissed. I'm going to say he's pissed on social media. He's pissed. Wow.
The second one is God.
God.
Okay, God. Yes, you talk to him. You can talk to him. You don't have to be perfect in order to do that. Okay.
Do you work with Santa?
That's number two. Or your higher spiritual being, whatever that is for you. And the third one is writing.
Writing?
Now, writing is where you get out an actual... I suggest a pen and paper, no computers. There's something about being a press hard on a notepad and just write, and you just
sweet
say...
mother of I guess I sprayed with soap one time.
But the key to the writing is this, is then you don't go and distribute that around here, Xerox copies of...
Like Eminem.
And then hand that around. You burn it or you shred it or you get rid of it at an appropriate time, but you know, you don't put it underneath someone's pillow and go, yeah, I'm not mad at you, but look at this. Okay.
I'm going to say this right now, though. What we have to do, Thrivers, you have to find a way to release the tension if you're a business owner. If you bottle it up, as Z said, and you just hold on to it, you're going to lose your mind. You've got to find a way to release that. And I highly endorse every one of the action items that Dr. Zellner just said. And Daniel Goleman, he recommends these three steps. He says, deep breathe, go for a walk, write them and then reframe them. Like you said,
there you go. Write them. There you go.
Now, lesson number two, when we come back, we're going to teach you move number two, lesson number two on how to improve your emotional intelligence. And Marshall Morris, he's an expert at this. I'm telling you, when you come back, he's going to illuminate us. He's going to teach us. He's going to educate us. He's going to ruminate with us. He's going to teach you specifically about emotional intelligence because nobody knows more about emotional intelligence than Mixmaster Marshall Morris.
We fill out these papers, become a real business, and then we can get to the fun stuff.
Okay, do we want to be an S-Corp or a C-Corp?
Well, I think S-Corp stands for serious corporation, sure, and C's for casual, so...
I'm more serious, yeah. You're more casual,
well,
so...
let's just do both of them.
Check them both. Awesome. Okay, do we want to be non-profit or profit? I want to make money, so...
Yeah, profit, but I don't want to come across as greedy.
That's true. Okay, I'm going to mark non-profit because it sounds better.
Okay.
Okay?
Why are we even doing this?
Well, this is a limited liability form, so it would become a limited liability.
Wait. Limited liability?
Yeah.
I don't want to put any limits on this. We're going to the top.
Yes, we are.
How about unlimited liability?
Yes.
Put that down. Put it down.
Okay, I don't see that here.
Let's put a UN in front of the world.
Oh, honey, I think you picked up the wrong form. We need an unlimited liability company. We want to be a ULLC.
No, you want to limit your liability. That's the whole point.
Honey, this thing's going to be huge, so.
Why are you putting limits on us, Laura?
I'm not. If someone sues your business, they can't take our personal stuff.
I'm not scared of that. Okay, honey, I think if we're at the point where we're making so much money that we're being sued, I think we're doing pretty good.
Mm, real good, guys. Real good.
I didn't realize you had a PhD in accounting.
You can't get a PhD in accounting.
Bye, honey. Hey, give Jimmy a call.
Who's Jimmy?
You know Jimmy, the guy who's been arrested like 3 times and the court appointed him a lawyer?
Let's give him a call.
Call him up.
Jimmy?
Man, these guys are going to have a rude awakening when they get sued for the first time. There's a lot of legal hurdles you have to jump through when you start a business, and it pays to know what you're doing so you don't have problems in the long run. If you need help, then check out Thrive15.com. We have world-class mentors who teach thousands of courses in legal, management, and 18 other business categories. So if you're looking to start a business, grow your business, or advance in your career, Thrive15 is where you want to be. You can click below to start with a free trial, or click over here, this direction, to watch some samples of trainings or to take the tour. And if you have any specific business questions, we can help with that too. Our mentors have new content released on a weekly basis, and most of those trainings are based off of your questions. That's right. The trainings are actually answers to the questions you are looking for. So, what are you waiting for? Click below to get started, and until I see you again next time electronically, thrive on.
Where are the Rutherford files?
I shipped them.
You shipped them?
I FedExed them to Dallas, like you said.
Give them to Dallas.
What's up?
Yeah, hold on a second. Hey, Deborah, can you pick up my kids?
Just get the other stuff to Austin.
Is anyone here named Austin?
Do you guys even know what kind of pressure I'm under? Hey, can somebody make me some food?
Appreciate you guys.
Oh!
Negative 2.5! Who's gonna pay for my yacht insurance?
Bump it on over to Hibetica. Oh, yeah. See how that made it better?
Hey, can somebody rub my feet?
Gotcha!
Hey, Jerry, can you hit me that brown file?
Yeah. No, it's good. I'm not doing anything.
You can't keep up this pace. You
doing this early morning stuff. You should just get a job somewhere.
Get a job.
This is crazy, right? Who in your family has ever owned a business?
Who's gonna help
you?
Who
do you think you are?
You don't even know what you're doing.
You're gonna fail.
This is so hard.
You can't do this.
You're gonna fail.
Get a job.
You're gonna ruin everything.
This is crazy.
You finish college. You never finish anything.
Just quit.
You know you want to.
You can't do this.
Quit.
Stop. Let's do this.
We're gonna make double instantly. I gotta go, I'm in a networking thing. What's up? My name's Steve. What do? I make everyone more money. You give me $2, I give you three. Boom, doubled. That's how we do it.
Hi, my name's Becky, and I do interior design, and I'm really good at it.
My name's Kyler. I'm into photography. I like to take pictures of just life and really existence, you know.
Oh my gosh, I just get so nervous at these networking things. I'm just like, oh, Marlene, calm down. You can do it.
I was at a networking event in China, okay? I don't even speak Chinese, but I got three businesses, doubled their yen, all right? Think about that.
You think I look hot? We should be Facebook friends.
I don't believe in business cards. You know, I just think, like, if the universe wants us to work together, you know, that our paths would cross.
I had a pregnancy scare, and that really changed me. I thought, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do with a sixth?
Why am I here networking with vicometers? No offense. Why am I here? So I can stay humble.
I didn't come here just to flirt with you. Maybe. They took a pint of fluids from my lower back.
I'm starting to get the feeling that the universe doesn't want me to get to know you.
Do you think I look like Reese Witherspoon? That is how I passed my kidney stone.
You gotta go. Bill Gates, see ya.
Hey, Bill.
Great meeting you. Can I have your number, please? No, where are you going?
Welcome back into the audio dojo of Mojo. I am back, and in fact, that is Michael Jack in your ear. My name is Clay Clark, and I'm here to help you learn how to start and grow a successful business. I'm the former SBA, that's the Small Business Administration Entrepreneur of the Year for the great state of Oklahoma. And I'm telling you what, if you're listening right now, you are our Oklahomies. We are kin. We are excited about you because it's a holiday season. There's a lot of things you could be doing, but you've decided to invest in yourself. You decided to learn how to start and grow a successful business. And I'm joined as always here with Dr. Robert Zellner, the co-host with the Mo-host.
Welcome, Thrivers, to Friday. Thank you. Made it. You made another week. And you know what this weekend is? It's time for Christmas.
Are you ready to sing Feliz Navidad? I hyped it up earlier. You're ready. You can lead the way.
Dessert time is not here yet. It's not time to eat your little sugar cookie. It's not time.
Okay.
We're going to take that on the outro out. It's a little dessert, and we've been practicing on it all day long. I've been stretching.
Yeah.
Working on
one of us have a grasp of harmony, but we're going to go all in.
Yeah. And you know what's great? If you're on Facebook Live right now,
yeah,
and you want to see a beautiful person, just flip. If you're not on Facebook Live, flip it on. But the guy between us,
we're
making a Marshall sandwich here.
He's 6'8" of great. You ever heard of Marshall Law?
Yeah.
That's what this is. It's Martial Law. It's a law. Mixmaster Marshall Morris, he's executive producer of the Thrivetime Show. And we're talking today about Daniel Goleman and specifically this concept he came up with called emotional intelligence. And what they found, they being Dr. Carol Dweck, Daniel Goleman, researchers, is that the biggest predictor of your success is not your intelligence quotient, aka your IQ, but it's your EQ. So if you have high intelligence, but you don't know how to input empathize and emotionally connect with other people, it's going to be tough. And so lesson number one was you got to make sure you can deal with issues as they come up. But because, by the way, they're going to come up. Now, lesson number two is you don't want to ruminate when you're sad. You want to distract yourself instead. Now, the definition of rumination is to give serious and careful thought to the idea. You're basically just brooding, Marshall. You're thinking negative thoughts over and over and over to the point where it leaves you in a state of sadness. Marshall, walk me through why the top entrepreneurs that you've had a privilege to coach over the years, why you've noticed what kind of pattern have you noticed as their ability to emotionally rebound quickly?
Okay, so this is huge because the entrepreneurs that they don't wallow. I love that word, wallow in the problem. Okay, so maybe an employee, we had a client that I was working with, they had an employee made a bonehead decision.
Okay. Dumb
decision.
We've all done it.
Not because the employee was bad natured or trying to, you know, sink the ship or anything like that. It was just a bad decision.
Yeah.
So you got to be hard on the problem, not hard on the person.
Oh, come on now.
And they move past it. Okay. So they move past it. They didn't just sit there and wallow for weeks on end. Oh my gosh, this costs the company money. They were hard on the problem, soft on the person, and they move past it.
Now, Daniel Goleman suggests things to do if you're going through a rough patch or you have an issue that had rises in the office or in your personal life. One is, he says, funny movies. Two is, he says, two is workouts.
I'm going to pump you up. That's right. Get out the way to just pump stuff.
Third
up.
Is, he says, Dr. Zellner sponsored events. What does that mean?
That means you're going to have some fun. We're going to have some fun. It's because we know when to cook the pig. Come on.
I'm going to tell you this, though. I'm telling you, when you're listening right now, and if you're listening right now and you've gone through the last 10 years without a one of the thrivers, this is a true story, kind of sad. But his mother was T-boned in a car accident less than 48 hours ago. And Dominic, if you're listening right now, we're praying for you. And his mom is in the hospital, and she's in sort of a coma state. My wife called her today to pray for her. It's a tough deal. It literally just happened. I found out about it just today at about 2:00. And my dad, you know, was suffering through ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease. If you're listening right now, I mean, we're all going through something, are we not? I mean, no one's out there listening going, it's just perfect. Santa, that's all I do. It's just Santa. I love Will Ferrell. I love Santa. It's perfect. And we're all going through something. The key is, if you're going through hell, don't stop. You got to keep going. And you've got to find a way to quickly distract yourself and get yourself back in the game if you're an entrepreneur. Okay, you can't just wallow on that. So, Dr. Z, what are some moves or tips that maybe you have when you're going through a really bad spot? I mean, how do you either distract yourself or get yourself over it? What do you do?
Well, I love what Goldman says, too. Do small tasks. There's little things maybe that you go, I need to get done, and little things you can do that can keep your mind busy, even your body busy. Working out. I like playing soccer, for instance. I think, you know, tennis is a good workout. But whatever your move is on the workout, whether you actually go to the gym or you get on a treadmill, but physical exercise is just really good whenever you're kind of ruminating or you don't want to ruminate on something like that, you know. And I think going to a movie. I mean, you know, Rogue One just came out this last weekend. You know, go to Rogue One or go to a movie that you've been wanting to see. Buy yourself a big thing of popcorn and, you know, sit there and just pound popcorn and watch the movie. You know, those are the kind of distractions. Also, reading books is another move that I would do is read books. But, you know, you want to just keep yourself busy and do something fun. So whatever's fun for you, you know, you want to kind of gravitate toward that.
Now, lesson number three, we're moving on. Lesson number three of emotional intelligence is you're going to have to learn the artful critique. How to criticize the right way. I'm going to go ahead and give you the rules, but I want to have you, Dr. Z, and Marshall kind of unpack this for us. Okay, so here's what you don't do. You don't just walk up to someone and go, Greg, you are screwing up. I mean, I want to tell you what, Greg. I mean, you are just a one.
You're an epic failure today, Greg.
Boom. I talk about awesome and I don't talk about you. You know what I mean? Now, move number two, the best critique, the way to critique is you want to be specific. Offer a solution, do it face to face and show empathy. I repeat, you might want to write these down. It might be tough if you're at Oklahoma Joe's right now enjoying your baked beans, but you might want to get a spork out and just sort of engrave it into your napkin right now. Just do what you have to do. If you're at Oklahoma Joe's enjoying the baked beans from our gracious sponsor, then you got to do what you got to do with the spork. But here's the four rules. Be specific. 1, 2, offer a solution. 3, do it face to face. 4, show empathy. Z, walk us through being specific, offering a solution, do it face to face, show empathy, go for it.
Hey, Billy, you got a minute?
Yes. Yeah, I do.
Come on in here, Billy. I want to talk to you about something.
Okay, cool. What's up, bro?
You see, Billy, there's a thing we have called the checklist.
Oh, okay, cool, yeah.
There's a thing called the script when you're answering the phone.
Yeah,
okay?
Script, yeah.
And you're not following the script.
I was just trying to do it overall, like just more of a guideline, you know what I'm saying?
So here's what we're going to do, Billy.
Okay.
From here on out, I need you, where is your script? Do you have your script?
I was left it in my car because it's more like a part of me.
Well, let's get you a new copy of the script, Billy, okay?
Okay, got it.
And you know, I know it's challenging at times, and I know sometimes you think you want to go with the flow and you want to try to do it on your own, but this is the proven way we do it here at the company.
Okay.
And so, you know, you're not following it. We're going to give you an opportunity to follow it.
Got it.
Telling you this,
cool.
Man-to-man, face-to-face, and I don't want to have this conversation again with you, Billy.
Cool.
And I'm cheering for you, and I know you can do it.
I'm cool with it. I'm cool, man. I'm cool. I appreciate that. I appreciate you being real with me. I'm going to go cry in my car for about an hour, and I'm going to come back in. I just got to get to Oklahoma Joe's. I got to call my mom, and I'll be back. I appreciate that candor, bro. We had a thing. We had a moment that just occurred right there.
Can we hug it out now?
Let's hug it out.
Let's hug it out.
At Oklahoma Joe's. Stay tuned.
Doing?
I'm just cleaning the bathroom.
Looks good. Let's go to lunch.
All right.
I'm great. I feel kind of short tonight, though.
Do you?
I mean, today. I'm sorry. Today and tonight, but today especially.
You look beautiful, though.
Well, I thank you. I appreciate that. But standing next to me is like a former... Were you semi-pro or would you call a professional basketball player?
I got paid.
Well, then he's a
sellout.
I'm standing next to a professional basketball player at Marshall Morris. It was standing in at 6'8".
Of great.
Weighing in at probably, what, 200, 220?
His body 220, is so big.
He's lean and he's mean. And he's,
it's a great body.
You know, hey, can you still dunk it? Marshall, can you still dunk it?
I can. I did the other weekend. It was pretty impressive. I was actually surprised.
Is that like on a 10-foot? Is that like the 10-foot thing? Do like me where you crank it
down? How many third graders were you playing against? You did dunk. Where were you at? Where were you playing?
I was playing in Sunday League here in Tulsa. It was awesome.
Where's the Sunday League at?
It's actually out at the Salvation Army out in Brooklyn.
Broken Arrow on 91st. It was serious. It was the competitive league. Now I've moved up from the rec league, which I was playing in for so long. Now the competitive league.
Wow. Now you're finishing the bottom of the barrel. Are you keeping up with the guys? Or, I mean,
I'll tell you what. 94 feet is much longer now than it used to be.
Wow. Okay. Now here's the deal, Thrivers. We're talking today about emotional intelligence. And you might say, why do I care? I will tell you this. I know many people have a great idea and can't ever raise capital because they don't know how to emotionally connect. I know many people who have a great business plan and they can't ever convince someone to come join their team. I know many people who are very good at coding out a website, but they cannot raise the awareness about their product because they don't know how to connect with other humans. It's just, it's a concerning deal. And Daniel Goleman wrote about it eloquently in his book called Emotional Intelligence. That's what we're helping you today. We spend so much time teaching you IQ in the world of academia, but very little time teaching you about the emotional intelligence, which, by the way, I tell people 2/3 of the human body, Dr. Z, correct me, it's water, right? It's medically speaking.
I mean, medically speaking, yes.
2/3 of life is emotion, so deal with it. Lesson number 4, emotional contagion. The definition of contagion. Well, contagion, okay, is something that like it spreads. Say, so emotions are contagious. We've all known it experimentally. You know, after you have a really fun coffee with a friend, you feel good. When you have a rude clerk in a store, you walk away feeling bad. Daniel Goleman. You want to set the emotional tone. Dr. Z, you have the floor here, my friend. Setting the tone. Why is it so important for you as a business owner, as an entrepreneur, as a human on the planet Earth who wants to have some success, why do you have to absolutely accept the fact that your emotions are contagious?
Well, because you are the head of your business. And just literally, physically look at it like that. And as the head, you're telling the rest of the body where to go, how to get there, what to do, okay?
I want all the kids to shut up and get in the car. We're going to have a great time at Disney World, but I need everyone to shut up.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
And so I don't know how many times that I have walked into my offices and I've had something deep on my thought. I'm in a not the best of mood. Something
where
just happened.
Where is my remote? Where is it?
What's going on? And all of a sudden I look up and I go, why is everyone in a bad mood today?
Why?
Just snap out of it. What's going on? Smile. Why are you not smiling, Billy? Nancy, start smiling. I mean, come on, guys. What's up? Hey, come on. It's great
just
day to be
because
alive.
I took hog's blood and put it all over the walls does not mean it's weird here.
No.
I just was going through a thing. I'm tired of looking at that hog, and I had to butcher him right here in the office. Nothing weird's going on. Holy crap. Please focus.
But I'll tell you what, folks. If you come in and you shake off the stuff that's happened bad, because we all have it every single day of our lives, and when you go in there as the leader of your organization, you've got to put a smile on. You got to fake it. Some days you just got to absolutely fake it.
I'm doing good. I just, the hog, he died in my office.
What is that? You can't. I'm the pig guy. You can't be the hog guy.
You know Animal House.
That's my animal zone. You're more like the chicken.
Do you remember
dude.
Animal House, the movie Animal House?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Where they go in there trying to play a prank. So they walk the dog into Dean Warmer's office.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And they fire a blank, but the horse gets so scared it has a heart attack and
dies right there. The horse. Yeah, yeah.
If you haven't seen it, go watch it on YouTube or something. But that's kind of what I envision when a boss is upset.
Yeah, he just takes a horse into the office, fires off a gun, pretends like he's shooting the horse and falls over dead.
It's the elephant in the room.
Yeah.
And Marshall, talk to me about it. Why is it so hard? Because you manage people. You've led our morning meetings. You do recruiting. When you are just beside yourself so mad that people can't figure out how to get to work on time, why is it so important not to just broadcast that with great passion?
Well, it's a momentum. You have an office momentum, an office pulse, and you as a manager or business owner, you got to set that. And everybody else will follow suit because whoever is the most passionate in the office, whatever that emotion is, whether it's anger, whether it's excitement, whether it's sadness, the strongest emotion in the room will always win.
Ooh, wow.
Well,
emotion off.
I'm just telling you, that's how it works. And I think if you're listening right now, if you're being honest with yourself, I want you to go ahead and you're going, I'm not honest with myself. I love to lie to myself. I prefer just to be false with myself. That's another show. But we're going ahead and go through the 4 lessons. I'm going to recap them real quick, and I want you to rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 on your ability to manage these effectively.
You're listening to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Lesson number 2, how effectively do you vent in a safe and productive way? Lesson number 2, how long are you ruminating over issues? How long are you just venting and venting and venting? 3, Artful critique. How good are you at delivering an artful critique to your team members? And four, your emotional contagion. How good are you at being able to be upset, but kind of a poker face and not necessarily broadcast that to the planet at the wrong time? I mean, how good are you at doing that? Now, Z, many people have been asking. They're hitting us up on Facebook Live. They're emailing us. They're going, you guys talked about singing Feliz Navidad. I'm waiting for it. I'm going, when is it going to happen? It's Christmas. Is this last show before Christmas? Dr. Z, I mean, you know.
I think we lead out with it. You know, we've got a few more minutes in this show. And I tell you what, people out there listening.
Jesus.
I know. That's what I do. Hey, listen, it's Friday. It's the last show before Christmas. We have a special treat for you. Yes, we are going to serenade you. So watch out.
Watch out.
You've been warned. All the FCC guidelines have been followed. We warned them in due time. So they have time to get into a truck stop, get off the highways.
We apologize for the next 30 seconds of unexcellence.
Next 30 seconds is a test. It's a test to see whether you can keep listening or not. So,
yep.
But here's the deal, Clay. You know, two years ago, you got me down this rabbit hole.
Yeah, I did.
And you came up to me and said, hey, listen, I love business coaching. And
I
said, well, I love mentoring young entrepreneurs. And you said, you know, it's too bad we have a limit on how many hours in a day there are.
That's true.
Yeah. And I said, boy, that's right. He said, that's a problem.
It is a problem.
And I said, you know, all great entrepreneurs, you find a problem and then fix it. Then that's how they get their business going.
Yeah.
And you said, I think I know a way to fix that problem. I said, well, do tell.
Are you ready, Z, to walk the plank of Thrive15.com? Arr.
You said, hey, let's make an online website.
Arr.
Where people can log in and by categories and by different mentors, you know, so you can either look up or you got a favorite mentor, you can, you know, you want to hear Jill Donovan's story about Rustic Cuff, you can just, you know, zone in on her. You want to hear Lee Cockrell's story about running Disney World, you can listen to him. Or by categories, then get on there and watch it and learn and laugh and have a great time with it, and they can encourage them,
yeah,
and educate them on how to start or grow their business.
Right.
And so then I said, I'm in. That's awesome. Let's do it.
Let's do it.
And we combed the country and we found millionaires and success stories and great guys. We even found a couple of tall guys.
Yeah, we had David Robinson, the NBA, the National Basketball Association, MVP. This is a guy who off the court has actually been more successful than he was on the court. He's the MVP of the NBA, two-time gold medal winner in the Olympics. But he went on to start Carver Academy, an unbelievable school. He, by the way, if you've driven by Academy Sports, That's his business.
And he's the only guy that makes Marshall look short.
Yeah, he does. Marshall judges him because he's too short. I can't even talk to him. I can't relate to him. Too short.
Yeah, he's like 7'7" something, right? 7 foot or whatever.
Yeah, so we built the world's best business school. It's called Thrive15.com. And then we had people reach out to us and go, I need one-on-one mentorship. And so we introduced a coaching program, Z.
Yeah, they said, hey, listen, this is good, but I want to take it to the next level. Do you have something for the next level? And we were looking at each other going, but do we have something for the next level? Let's get something for the next level.
And we did. I had been coaching clients one-on-one for years, and it's like, hey, let's scale that. Let's offer a way to do it. And we've democratized it. We've made it so inexpensive. For less money than it would cost you to hire a barista, you can have the world's best business coaching program and the succinct, repeatable systems that Dr. Zellner and I use in every one of our businesses.
But then some people said, I want one-on-one, but I don't want to do a monthly deal. Can I just come in and do like a deep dive? And we said, absolutely.
I want to come to a workshop.
Absolutely. Breakout things. And you can meet some of the mentors there. It's a two-day, 15-hour workshop. Or we go over a whole list of things.
We had to move buildings to go into a 20,000 square foot building here by the Jinx Riverwalk to accommodate everybody who wants to come to these things. It's unbelievable. It's a game changer.
So Thrive15.com, $19 a month. Go to it. Every time you get a membership, guess what? You're going to give a free one to the military. And you know what time it is, folks?
It is time for the unveiling of
Feliz Navidad. Okay,
here we go.
So we've been practicing, so let's see if we get this right.
1, 2, 3, here we go. Feliz Navidad. Navidad. Come on, Z-Lita, here we go. Hey.
Feliz Navidad.
Ba-da-da-da-ba.
Feliz Navidad.
Buy glasses at Zellner's. Felicidad.
We want to wish you a Merry Christmas.
Everybody sing it with me.
We want to wish you a Merry Christmas.
Oh, yeah.
We want to wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of our heart.
Thrive15.com. 3, 2, 1, boom!
The number of new customers that we've had is up 411% over last year. We are Jared and Jennifer Johnson. We own Platinum Pest and Lawn and are located in Owosso, Oklahoma. And we have been working with Thrive for business coaching for almost a year now.
Yeah. So what we want to do is we want to share some wins with you guys that we've had by working with Thrive.
First of all, we're on the top page of Google now, okay? I just want to let you know what type of accomplishment this is. Our competition, Orkin, Terminix, they're both $1.3 billion companies. They both have 2,000 to 3,000 pages of content attached to their website. So to basically go from virtually non-existent on Google to up on the top page is really saying something. But that's come by being diligent to the systems that Thrive has, being consistent and diligent on doing podcasts and staying on top of those podcasts to really help with getting up on with their listing and ranking there with Google.
And also, we've been trying to get Google reviews, you know, asking our customers for reviews. And now we're the highest rated and most reviewed pest and lawn company in the Tulsa area. And that's really helped with our conversion rate. And the number of new customers that we've had is up 411% over last year.
Wait, say that again. How much are we up?
411%.
Okay. So 411% we're up with our new customers. Amazing.
Right. So not only do we have more customers calling in, we're able to close those deals at a much higher rate than we were before. Right now, our closing rate is about 85%, and that's largely due to, first of all, like our Google reviews that we've gotten. People really see that our customers are happy, but also we have a script that we follow. And so when customers call in, they get all the information that they need. That script has been refined time and time again. It wasn't a one and done deal. It was a system that we followed with Thrive in the refining process, and that has obviously the 411% shows that system works.
Yeah. So here's a big one for you. So last week alone, our booking percentage was 91%. We actually booked more deals, more new customers last year than we did the first 5 months. Or I'm sorry, we booked more deals last week than we did the first 5 months of last year from before we worked with Thrive. So again, we booked more deals last week than the first 5 months of last year. And it's incredible. But the reason why we have that success is by implementing the systems that Thrive has taught us and helped us out with. So.
Some of those systems that we've implemented are group interviews. That way we've really been able to come up with a really great team. We've created and implemented checklists. That way everything gets done and it gets done right. It creates accountability. We're able to make sure that everything gets done properly, both out in the field and also in our office. And also doing the podcast, like Jared had mentioned, that has really, really contributed to our success. But that, like I said, the diligence and consistency in doing those in that system has really, really been a big blessing in our lives. And also, you know, it's really shown that we've gotten the success from following those systems. Yeah.
So before working with Thrive, we were basically stuck. Really no new growth with our business. And we're in a rut and
The last 3 years, our customer base had pretty much stayed the same. We weren't shrinking, but we weren't really growing either.
Yeah. And so we didn't really know where to go, what to do, how to get out of this rut that we're in. But Thrive helped us with that. You know, they implemented those systems, that they taught us those systems. They taught us the knowledge that we needed in order to succeed. Now it's been a grind. Absolutely. It's been a grind this last year. But we're getting those fruits from that hard work and the diligent effort that we're able to put into it. So again, we were in a rut. Thrive helped us get out of that rut. And if you're thinking about working with Thrive, quit thinking about it and just do it. Do the action, and you'll get the results. It will take hard work and discipline. But that's what it's going to take in order to really succeed. So we just want to give a big shout out to Thrive, a big thank you out there to Thrive. We wouldn't be where we're at now without their help.
Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Moore. I'm a pediatric dentist. Through our new digital marketing plan, we have seen a marked increase in the number of new patients that we're seeing every month, year over year. 1 month, for example, we went from 110 new patients the previous year to over 180 new patients in the same month. And overall, our average is running about 40 to 42% increase month over month, year over year. The group of people required to implement our new digital marketing plan is immense, starting with a business coach, videographers, photographers, web designers. Back when I graduated dental school in 1985, nobody advertised. The only marketing that was ethically allowed in everybody's eyes was mouth-to-mouth marketing. By choosing to use the services, you're choosing to use a proven turnkey marketing and coaching system.
that will grow your practice and get you the results that you're looking for. I went to the University of Oklahoma College of Dentistry, graduated in 1983, and then I did my pediatric dental residency at Baylor College of Dentistry from 1983 to 1985.
Hello, my name is Charles Kolaw with Kolaw Fitness. Today I want to tell you a little bit about Clay Clark and how I know Clay Clark. Clay Clark has been my business coach since 2017. He's helped us grow from 2 locations to now 6 locations. We're planning to do 7 locations in 7 years and then franchise. And Clay has done a great job of helping us navigate anything that has to do with like running the business, building the systems, the checklists, the workflows, the audits, how to navigate lease agreements, how to buy property, how to work with brokers and builders. This guy is just amazing. He's this kind of guy has worked in every single industry. He's written books with like Lee Crockerell, head of Disney, with the 40,000 cast members. He's friends with like Mike Lindell. He does Reawaken America tours, where he does these tours all across the country where 10,000 or more people show up to some of these tours. On the day-to-day, he does anywhere from about 160 companies. He's at the top. He has a team of business coaches, videographers, and graphic designers and web developers, and they run 160 companies every single week. So think of this guy with a team of business coaches running 160 companies. So in the weekly, he's running 160 companies. Every 6 to 8 weeks, he's doing Reawaken America tours. Every 6 to 8 weeks, he's also doing business conferences where 200 people show up, and he teaches people a 13-step proven system that he's done and worked with billionaires, helping them grow their companies. I've seen guys from startups go from startup to being multimillionaires, teaching people how to get time freedom and financial freedom through the system. Critical thinking, document creation, making it, putting it into organizing everything in their head to building it into a franchisable, scalable business. Like one of his businesses has like 500 franchises. That's just one of the companies or brands that he works with. So amazing guy, Elon Musk kind of like smart guy. He kind of comes off sometimes as socially awkward, but he's so brilliant and he's taught me so much. When I say that, like Clay is like, he doesn't care what people think when you're talking to him. He cares about where you're going in your life and where he can get you to go. And that's what I like the most about him. He's like a good coach. A coach isn't just making you feel good all the time. A coach is actually helping you get to the best you. And Clay has been an amazing business coach. Through the course of that, we became friends. I was really most impressed with him is when I was shadowing him one time. We went into a business deal and listened to it. I got to shadow and listen to it. And when we walked out, I knew that he could make millions on the deal. And they were super excited about working with him. And he told me, he's like, I'm not going to touch it. I'm going to turn it down. Because he knew it was going to harm the common good of people in the long run. And the guy's integrity just really wowed me. It brought tears to my eyes to see that this guy, his highest desire was to do what's right. And anyways, just an amazing man. So anyways, impacted me a lot. He's helped navigate. Anytime I've got nervous or worried about how to run the company or, navigating competition and an economy that's like, I remember we got closed down for 3 months. He helped us navigate on how to stay open, how to get back open, how to just survive through all the COVID shutdowns, lockdowns.
I'm Rachel with Tip Top Canine, and we just want to give a huge thank you to Clay and Vanessa Clark.
Hey guys, I'm Ryan with Tip Top Canine. Just want to say a big thank you to Thrive 15. Thank you to Make Your Life Epic. We love you guys. We appreciate you and really just appreciate how far you've taken us.
This is our old house, right? This is where we used to live years ago. This is our old neighborhood. See? It's nice, right?
So this is my old van and our old school marketing. And this is our old team. And by team, I mean it's me and another guy.
This is our new house with our new neighborhood.
This is our new van with our new marketing, and this is our new team. We went from 4 to 14, and I took this beautiful photo. We worked with several different business coaches in the past, and they were all about helping Ryan sell better and just teaching sales, which is awesome, but Ryan is a really great salesman, so we didn't need that. We needed somebody to help us get everything that was in his head out into systems, into manuals and scripts, and actually build a team. So now that we have systems in place, we've gone from 1 to 10 locations in only a year.
In October 2016, we grossed $13,000 for the whole month. Right now it's 2018, the month of October. It's only the 22nd. We've already grossed a little over 50 grand for the whole month, and we still have time to go. We're just thankful for you, thankful for Thrive and your mentorship, and we're really thankful that you guys have helped us to grow a business that we run now instead of the business running us. Just thank you, thank you, thank you, times a thousand. Whoa.
The Thrivetime Show 2-day interactive business workshops are the world's highest rated and most reviewed business workshops because we teach you what you need to know to grow.
You can learn the proven 13-point business systems that Dr. Zellner and I have used over and over to start and grow successful companies. I mean, we get into the specific steps on what you need to do to optimize your website. We're going to teach you how to fix your conversion rate. We're going to teach you how to do a social media marketing campaign that works. How do you raise capital? How do you get a small business loan? We teach you everything you need to know here during a 2-day, 15-hour workshop. It's all here for you. You work every day in your business, but for 2 days you can escape and work on your business and build these proven systems so now you can have a successful company that will produce both the time freedom and the financial freedom that you deserve. You're going to leave energized, motivated, but you're also going to leave empowered. The reason why I've built these workshops is because as an entrepreneur, I always wish that I had this. And because there wasn't anything like this, I would go to these motivational seminars, no money down, real estate, Ponzi scheme, get motivated seminars, and they would never teach me anything. It was like you went there and you paid for the big chocolate Easter bunny, but inside of it, it was a hollow nothingness. And I wanted the knowledge, and they're like, oh, but we'll teach you the knowledge after our next workshop. And the great thing is we have nothing to upsell. At every workshop, we teach you what you need to know. There's no one in the back of the room trying to sell you some next big get-rich-quick, walk-on-hot-coals product. It's literally, we teach you the brass tacks, the specific stuff that you need to know to learn how to start and grow a business. And I encourage you to not believe what I'm saying, and I want you to Google the Z66 auto auction. I want you to Google elephant in the room. Look at Robert Zellner and Associates. Look them up and say, are they successful because they're geniuses, or are they successful because they have a proven system? When you do that research, you will discover that the same systems that we use in our own business can be used in your business. Come to Tulsa, book a ticket, and I guarantee you it's going to be the best business workshop ever, and we'll even give you your money back if you don't love it. We've built this facility for you, and we're excited to see you.
Now you may be thinking, what does it actually cost to attend an in-person 2-day interactive Thrivetime Show business workshop? Well, good news, the tickets are $250 or whatever price that you can afford. What? Yes, they're $250 or whatever price you can afford. I grew up without money and I know what it's like to live without money. So if you're out there today and you want to attend our in-person 2-day interactive business workshop, all you got to do is go to thrivetimeshow.com to request those tickets. And if you can't afford $250, we have scholarship pricing available to make it affordable for you.